Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Bait by Kenneth Abel, narrated by Frank Muller. This book is copyrighted 1994 by Kenneth Abel. This recording is copyrighted 1995 by Recorded Books. The life and career of narcotics detective Jack Walsh goes to hell the night his partner gets shot. First, he drinks to blank out the memory. Then, getting drunk leads to the accident where Boston's boss of bosses, Johnny D'Angelo, loses his only son. It's Walsh's car that ploughs into the boy's birthday Mazda, and Walsh's badge that makes the whole tragedy seem suspicious. Maybe the collision is pure chance, but one thing is sure. Johnny D'Angelo needs to ease his family's grief by making Jack Walsh pay. And now, Bait.
Chapter 1.
Let him die, save us all trouble.
Laughter. He tried to lift his head. A hand settled on his forehead, shoved him back.
He's up. Got a vein?
Cold metal on his forearm. His sleeve was torn back. A hand rolled his hand into a fist, squeezed. A sting as the needle went in. The strap tightened around his wrist with a jerk. No pain. There should be pain. If you feel it, you make it. That's what they told you, the guys with the bullet scars on their bellies, grinning at you when they lift their shirts. Too fast to think, they said. Before and after, nothing in between. One minute you're standing there, and the next, a flash in a dark hallway, so bright you can almost see the bullet streak toward you, your hands slick with sweat, trying to get the gun down, but there's nothing to shoot at in the dark. At the end of the hall, the sound of a window breaking. And then, behind you, Jerry thrashing on the stairs. You're trying to hold him down, but he's jerking away, moaning. There's blood everywhere, and suddenly he's not moving anymore. He's smiling, the asshole, shaking his head, blood coming out of his nose, saying, "It's the ones you don't feel that..." In the hospital, Jack Walsh was still a cop. Private room. Card from the union on the table. A drawing of a guy in traction, tongue hanging out, a pretty nurse peeking under the sheet saying, "Well, that's not broken." The other side, they called it. You took the bullet, woke up to flowers, 3 weeks of hospital food, soap operas through a thick haze of morphine. You're a hero, just for being alive. You get a medal for breathing, the joke goes. Two if you can fill the bedpan. It was the lawyer that ruined it. He showed up early in the afternoon, poking his head through the door. "Well, you're up." He pushed the door open, squeezed into the room. A heavy man, wheezing, his shirt tight across his stomach. He squinted behind his glasses. "The doctor said you'd sleep a few more hours, but I figured, what the hell, I'm here, I'll have a look. Save myself a trip, you know?" He settled into a chair, grasping his briefcase between his knees. He leaned forward, thrust out a damp hand. "Don Markoff, feel up to a talk, Jack?" "You understand, Jack, the department has to do this." The lawyer balanced the briefcase on the edge of the bed, digging through a thick wad of papers. "It's a disclaimer. It just says you weren't on duty when the accident occurred, that you were operating the vehicle without the authorization of the department, not in your capacity as an officer. It's a liability thing, you understand, Jack?" He drew a paper from the briefcase, placed it delicately on the bed. Jack's leg hurt, suddenly, like someone had yanked a blanket off him. Burning, they tell you, like a hot poker shoved right through you, so you want to pour water on it. He tried to focus on the lawyer's word. "Accident," he said. "A disclaimer. My capacity as an officer." He shook his head. That wasn't it. What this felt like was,
He wanted to say gravel popping under a truck's wheels, like someone took a hammer to the front of his leg, went right up from the ankle to the hip, cracking the bone. You with me, Jack? The lawyer frowned, tapped at the paper with one finger. I've got to have your attention on this. You're covered, but the department needs this before it can process your claim.
Tell me again. The lawyer gave a sigh. He was going to have trouble with this one.
Handsome guy, strong face, all that dark hair, like a Kennedy, maybe, one of the kids. Eyes that look right into you, even through the drugs. Cop's eyes. But you could see the liquor in his face. Swollen. He picked up the paper, held it out. You signed this. You're just saying you weren't on duty. You don't have to admit anything about how it happened. That's for the review board. You're just saying that the department shouldn't be responsible. You got it?
You think I could get a nurse in here?
In a minute, Jack. This is important. You're going to live with this for a long time. In my experience, it doesn't hurt to cooperate. The duty log says you signed out Friday night at 10:42. The call came in at 3:38 Saturday morning.
He grinned.
You had yourself a time, didn't you? They got some nice blood work on you, found a bottle in the car. There's a witness, old guy in a cab, says you didn't even slow down, went right through the light. How's that look, Jack? The girl, she was telling him on the scene how you had a few at the hotel.
Ah, shit. Chris.
The lawyer caught his expression, smiled. You're a married guy, aren't you, Jack? That girl's going to be a problem for all of us. Hardly a scratch on her, but you watch. She's got a lawyer by now, going to retire on the department if you don't sign this. And the kid. Well, you want the truth, that's going to be your worry, not mine. His people don't go to court. Not by choice, anyway.
What kid? The lawyer paused, rubbed at his chin.
They didn't tell you?
Tell me what?
The kid, Jack. In the other car.
His leg was on fire now. He tried to shift his weight, but his hips wouldn't move. He pulled the sheet back. The cast extended up his left leg, encasing his hips. The lawyer was watching him.
The kid died, Jack. He had one of those little Mazdas, the convertible, you know? Brand new, red one. Got it for his birthday, I heard. I saw it this morning, Jack. Looked like when you step on a beer can. They had to cut it in half to get him out.
He gestured toward the door.
Nobody's been in here to talk to you?
Just you.
Jesus. You don't even know who you killed.
He sat back, tugging at his collar.
You fucked up, Jack.
Kate Haggerty crossed the street, carrying the sack carefully. 4 coffees, 3 black with sugar, 1 light. 3 years of law school, 1 year of clerking, 2 with the U.S. Attorney's Office, and she was getting coffee. She walked up the block, past the auto body shop, the hair salon, the fish market, to where the van was parked in a lot across from the funeral parlor. She wasn't complaining. This was her operation. Riccioli had made that clear. It was a stroke of luck. The emergency room doctor knew her from college. He recognized the kid, figured she might want to know. She'd called the judge, could run the subpoena out to his house in 30 minutes. The judge agreed to sign it, but he wanted Riccioli's name on it. That's fine, young lady. The judge's tone was patient, as with a child. Now you just call up your boss and have him sign the paper. You understand? Yeah, she understood. Young lady. The way they looked at her when she stood before the bench, the half-smile, thinking such a pretty girl, eyes on her runner's body, watching her move, wondering why she pulled that pretty red hair straight back. She clenched her teeth, dialed Riccioli's house.
They're going to take him to Di Napoli, she told him. That's where the family goes.
Do it,
Riccioli growled, his voice still thick with sleep, then hung up. 3 hours later, the van was in place, the microphones transmitting the sounds of footsteps, a coffee pot gurgling, a man belching. It was a long shot, she'd admit. Still, it was her show to run. If the guys hunched over their headsets in the back of the van wanted coffee, she'd get it.
She tapped at the door. It opened a crack and she climbed in. The ambulance bearing the mortal remains of Vincent D'Angelo turned into the narrow drive just before noon. Haggerty watched the driver swing the door open, slide the stretcher out, dropping the wheels. An attendant appeared at the door, and they wheeled the stretcher up the shallow ramp.
"Used to be a good-looking kid. We did commercials, you know, on the TV."
The attendant's voice was thin over the headset, distant.
"I seen one just the other night, toothpaste."
Haggerty saw one of the men make a note in his log.
"Mosca," the man said. "The mortician's assistant. He's been in there all morning since they got the call."
"His head went through the windshield, got stuck there."
The other voice was deeper, a faint accent. Spanish, Haggerty figured, the driver.
"Ain't that some shit?"
"You want to sign this, Tony?"
"Give it here. You want coffee? Cups under the counter."
A rustle of paper.
"His father tells us he wants an open casket. You believe that?"
"You gonna tell him no?"
"Do I look stupid?"
A faint clink, then another. Haggerty imagined the attendant bending over the body, picking bits of glass from the flesh with a tweezer, dropping them onto a tray.
"Jesus, look at him. How'd you like to be the asshole did this to Johnny's boy?"
Russo swung the Lincoln into the driveway under the blue awning.
"Keep going, around back."
"Listen to him," Russo thought. "Like he's telling you where to pick up his laundry." He parked it next to the ambulance, walked up the ramp to ring the bell. When the door buzzed, he pushed it open, waved to the car.
"Here we go,"
Harmon raised his camera. "Johnny boy." A stocky man in a pale suit, gray hair swept back, got out of the car, hurried up the ramp. The camera whirred, tracking him.
"Just Russo," Harmon murmured. "He's traveling light."
At the rear of the van, one of the quiet men flicked a switch. The reels of tape began to turn slowly. Russo stepped back, holding the door.
"Gray van," he said, "in the lot across the street."
Johnny D'Angelo paused in the shadow of the door, lowered his sunglasses. He smoothed his hair back, straightened his tie. His eyes looked tired.
"Assholes," he said. "They've got no shame."
"You see him spot us?" Harmon lowered the camera as the door swung shut. "Pretty quick."
"They've had practice. You're not going to get much here."
"We get what we get." Haggerty watched the ambulance driver emerge, back out, swinging wide around the Lincoln. "How's he look?"
"Like shit."
Harmon slipped the lens cap onto the camera, made a note in his log.
"Sometimes I hate this job."
Riccioli didn't look up from the papers scattered on the desk before him. It was a thick file, the tab marked in Riccioli's broad scrawl, "Johnny D." Haggerty watched him flip through the pages quickly. She knew the contents. A brief police sheet, mostly from the early 60s. 3 years at Lewisburg on an auto theft and transport charge. Probation officer's statement, attitude poor. Informants reports from 2 decades, the name marked in red. In recent years, entire pages ran red. Photographs, starting with a mugshot of a young, tough, hair slicked back. Later, a man talking on a street corner, entering a restaurant, surrounded by reporters on the steps of a courthouse. Finally, 3 shots of dead men, one slumped in a car, blood streaming from his head, another sprawled in the street, his eyes staring. The last, an elderly man in an expensive silk suit, slouched at a cafe table, the back of his head blown off. Flipping to the end, she had been startled to find copies of the boy's death certificate, an autopsy report, and, barely 2 hours after the van had dropped her at the steps of the federal building, a transcript labeled, "DiNapoli Funeral Parlor, 7892.
"So you got nothing."
Riccioli rubbed his eyes. For a moment he looked like he needed sleep. When he looked up, it was gone. Funeral arrangements. He didn't stay long. They left him alone with the kid, maybe 5 minutes. I couldn't even hear him breathing.
You figure he spotted you.
Took him 30 seconds, maybe. Stay cool, she told herself. You're frustrated, but he doesn't have to see it.
Riccioli liked to sweat the younger lawyers, peering at them from under his eyelids, asking the obvious until they stumbled, finding a flaw where none was visible. She sat back, watching him scan the transcript. It was a shot. They've been running tapes out of the pizza joints for 3 years now. You come up empty in one day, he's going to start yelling. Johnny, they had discovered, was a very clever boy.
What about the cop?
A drinker. Put in more than 6 good years, promotions, transfer to narcotics. He lost a partner about 8 months ago, watched him bleed to death in the North End. After that...
You talk to him yet?
Not yet.
The girl?
Treated and released. I heard she came back to work at the courthouse this morning. They had to send her home.
All right. Riccioli sat back, fixing her with his eyes. He was a thin man, his face tanned from a recent vacation. 10, maybe 12 years older than me, Haggerty thought. Mid-40s, worked his way through law school, played the politics shrewdly, not bad for a grocer's son. A corner office, windows on 3 sides, huge mahogany desk, expensive leather couch. On the wall near the door, a picture of the president, smiling broadly, clasping his hand. In recent months, she'd heard talk of a run at the State House. The file on his desk looked worn, well-thumbed.
"I want you to pursue this," he said. Haggerty fought the urge to smile.
"There's probably nothing here, but it's worth a look. Let's get the van back over there. The man's grieving. He's angry. I want to know what he's saying, even if it's just ordering flowers."
"And the cop?"
Riccioli swung his chair toward the window, silent. He twisted a pen between his fingers.
"Get his story, then let the department handle it."
He paused, drew a pad toward him. Absently, he drew a box, put an X inside it.
"We play this one up front. The media asks us, we're calling it accidental death, but we're looking at vehicular homicide. Nothing special about this, you got it?"
"They're not going to buy that."
"No, they're not. But that's our line. We're respecting the family's privacy, you know? It's a tragedy, but these things happen."
He closed the pen, slipped it into his pocket. The pad disappeared into a drawer. He stood, reached for his coat. Haggerty rose, clutching at the papers on her lap.
"When they press you, give them the cop."
He smiled. "Maybe our friend Johnny would like to know who killed his son." Chapter 2. Ice. These little towns, they let the snow freeze on the sidewalks and the wind blows it smooth as glass. Jack Walsh eyed the long walk into town, his leg aching. 20 minutes for the bus. Athol. Like a kid with a lisp. A name to conjure with during 9 months in MCI. What better home for a failed cop, an ex-con, a drunk facing the cold morning sober? The place looked the same as he remembered it, just poorer. A mill town waking to its own hard morning after. You can't escape your past. One bus in the morning, running up the hill from the flats where the mill workers live, past the high school, then a long, slow loop past the mills along the river. Only the mills all moved to Georgia 10 years back. Everyone broke, living on credit. No jobs anywhere in the county. None in the whole state of Massachusetts lately. Movie house closed, radio station off the air. 3 cops in the whole town sitting in the donut shop every morning watching traffic. When he was a kid, he rode that bus to school, carved his name on the back of the last seat, couldn't wait to get out. Now he's standing on the edge of the road, wind cutting his face like bits of glass blowing through the pines, praying for that bus to come, knowing that if he gets on, pushes his way to the back, his name would be there. Some life. A mistake, the lawyer had called it.
Tough luck when it happens to you, but better than being the other guy, right? Still, if you're a cop, something like this happens, you start looking for work. The first reporters showed up at the hospital the same night. He could hear them arguing with the cop in the hall. Lying there in the dark, he felt like one of those chickens hanging in the window of a Chinese restaurant. He could imagine the picture stretched out on the bed, his leg dangling from its strap, face turned toward the camera, surprised. The cop who killed Johnny's boy. That's how you sell newspapers. He listened to them shouting in the hall, the nurses joining in now, trying to push them toward the elevators, the cop pressed against the door, telling them where to put their cameras. The department did that much, at least, kept the sharks off him for a few days. So they got Anne instead. Caught her coming into the lobby that night, cops trying to hustle her through the crowd of reporters, the lights making her look even paler. The wife. Thank God she didn't bring the kids. By the time she got to the room, she'd stopped crying, closed the door behind her quietly, just stood there looking at him, let him feel her silence. Finally, she laid her bag on the edge of the bed, glanced around the room. How do you feel? Like shit. And she nodded. What else could he say? I took the children to my mother. Do they know? Not yet. He shifted his weight. His leg ached. Beyond the window, he could see rain in the glare of a streetlight. Whenever he thought of that night, that's what he remembered. The rain falling, a cone of pale mist, the sound of Anne quietly sobbing. The bus appeared in the distance, headlights flickering as it bumped up the hill. The snow had begun to fall again. He shifted the cane to his left hand and dug in his pocket for change. The first step was tricky. Wedge the cane into the ground, get a grip on the inner edge of the door, heave. Worse when it's snowing, when the slush from a dozen pairs of shoes makes the floor slick, the ground so soft the cane twists out of your hand. Two women, clerks down at the Food King, watched him lurch down the aisle, their eyes blank. A small town likes a story, his brother Larry had said during the drive out. Eyes on the road, a careful driver. I can give you a job, a place to stay. But you can't hide it here. We get the papers, too. Local boy a dozen years gone. He had a friend in the bottle. One girl, too many. The bus rattled up the hill. He stared out the window, thinking of the girl. He hadn't noticed her at first, leaning against the counter while he filled out the requisition form, her fingers riffling the pages of a thick paperback. He felt her looking at him, her eyes amused behind those little round glasses like the hippies used to wear. Blonde hair pulled back into a thick braid. When he handed her the form, she smiled. He watched her walk back into the file stacks to pull the folder, her legs taut beneath the faded jeans. He picked up the book. It was in German. You can read this? He asked when she returned to the counter. If I work at it. What's it about? Death, she smiled, I think. He dropped the book on the counter. Sounds like fun. It's for a class. You a student? Night school. What do you study? She shrugged. Human nature. She peeled the pink carbon off the back of the form, scribbled her initials in one corner, and dropped it into a tray on the counter. She tucked the pencil behind her ear, tossed a stray lock of hair back with a flick of her wrist. Learn anything today? You ask a lot of questions. I'm a cop. Glad you're not a proctologist. It took a minute, but when he laughed, she rewarded him with a smile that made his knees weak. Points for accuracy. She pushed the file across the counter. But you gotta work on your time. 2 days later, he made time to take the file back, lingered by the counter to watch her carry it back into the stacks. Not beautiful, exactly.
Put her next to Anne, she'd look plain. But her small body glistened with youth. She looked untouched by time, hurt, the slow uncoiling of hope. She flirted easily with a confidence that swept aside fear. Watching her bend to slip the file onto a shelf, he felt his heart tighten with desire. Later, when he trailed one finger up the inside of her bare thigh, he discovered a tiny scar, a pale half-moon etched in the soft skin at the top of her leg. What happened here?
I grew up in Florida. We used to ride our bikes to the beach in our bathing suits. We had a shortcut through a fence. A nail cut me. I had to get a shot.
He bent, touched his tongue to the tiny ridge of flesh. She squirmed, raised her hips to meet him. He pushed the image from his mind. In recent months, he sometimes woke in the pale half-light before dawn, his body hot with the memory of her. Gripping his hips with her slim legs, her cries as they rocked against the mound of pillows on the creaking hotel bed. He drove the memory from his head with images of his children's faces, Anne sobbing in the hospital room, the boy's forehead streaked with blood when they pulled him from the crumpled car. It was this image that had haunted him in the hospital. When the papers got hold of his academy picture, matching it with a shot from the kid's high school graduation, he stopped shaving, letting the beard hide the flicker of pain in his jaw at each shuffling step. Get used to it, the doctors told him. You'll have it for the rest of your life. In bed for 2 weeks, then the wheelchair until his ribs healed enough for crutches. With therapy, they had him walking within a month. Quick, the doctors called it. But he had worked at it, sweating through hours of exercises, passing the nights flexing the muscles in his thigh and calf again and again while the television flickered. By that time, he had known the indictment was coming. He was told nothing, but lying there in the dark, the sweat beading on his forehead, he could picture the scene. The courtroom crowded with reporters, the prosecutor playing to the cameras, and the court sensing the public interest coming down hard. He would do time. Bad enough for a cop if he's healthy. On crutches with enemies, he wouldn't stand a chance. 2 weeks after the accident, he resigned from the department. At his trial, the boy's family sat in the front row. He recognized D'Angelo from the newspapers, watched him twist in his seat, smoothing his tie to whisper to a blunt-faced man in the row behind. The man stared at him, nodding. Walsh sat in silence as a parade of officers from his division testified about his years of service, the injuries he had suffered, his grief at his partner's death. The judge, hunched over his papers, avoided his gaze. Told to stand, he found his knee had stiffened, had to lean on the table to keep from falling. In the brief silence that followed, the boy's mother burst into tears. A young woman quieted her. From the corner of his eye, he saw D'Angelo tug at his collar, his face flushed. His eyes met Jack's, and he smiled sadly. Leaning forward, he raised one hand, blew gently across his palm, like a speck of dust. His lawyer, hired by the department, considered the sentence a victory. 18 months in a state medical facility. He would serve no more than 10. His injuries would keep him out of the general population where a cop could meet with an accident. He would spend his days in physical therapy, his evenings in counseling sessions for substance abusers. The department would notify the warden of his case. 2 cops from the South Shore had done time there on a misappropriations charge, spent 3 years shooting pool with the guards, sleeping in a storeroom next to the guard station. They had a VCR, the lawyer grinned, an account down at the video store, used to order out pizza. Pizza, Jack smiled. I can call D'Angelo's. But the lawyer had been right. He had done his time without a hitch, 9 months, 18 days. Sleeping in the infirmary, an intern's room off the chronic ward, fitted with a heavy lock that allowed the warden to claim him as a secured prisoner and let Jack sleep without jumping at every sound. He worked out, shifted papers in the infirmary office each afternoon. In the evenings, he went to AA, 30 prisoners crowded into a classroom, somberly reciting their failures. "My name is Jack, and I'm..." Beyond the steamed windows of the bus, the winter fields looked faded as an old photograph. He felt the old women's eyes on him. Maybe they remembered him. As a kid, he'd worked in his father's store every summer, hauling boxes out of the trucks, dragging them down the aisles to stock nails, light bulbs, garden shears, combination locks. At night, hitching the few miles into Gardner with his friends to try the bars, flirting with the girls behind the counter at the chicken fry, the local guys glaring at them from the parking lot. A couple of fights, a lot of tough talk. But it seemed like something was happening at the time. Now look at him, riding the same bus into town, spending the day perched behind a counter, cane propped against the stool, watching a local kid drag boxes along the aisles, slide a razor across the edge, peel the top back. Larry, sitting in the tiny office at the rear of the store, frowns at his columns of figures. Some nights, as the kid pushes a broom along the aisles, the cash registers spitting their totals onto long strips of paper that curl along the floor, he half expects to see his father on his toes beyond the window, stretching to drag the security grate down. Like nothing has changed. The other life a dream that fades in his coffee. Except that now, as the bus clatters over the tracks, past the old graveyard, he can almost see his father's stone among the pines. In his pocket, a letter from his wife's lawyer, which he will carry on his lunch hour across the square, past the courthouse, up a painful flight of stairs, to show the lawyer who handles his brother's collections. The lawyer, a heavy man in a wrinkled suit, squints at the pages, shakes his head, pushes the letter back across the desk. "They're gonna sue you," the lawyer says, "third-party complaint. Then they file for a judgment to get out of it, making you the sole defendant. This way the kid's family can't get the house." Jack nods, knowing this. The lawyer sits back in his chair, watching him fold the papers and slip them back into his pocket. "It's just procedure," he says. "What are they going to get from you? Your cane? You got nothing, so they get nothing. What's to worry about? You're safe." Safe. A thin snow swirls around him as he crosses the square. It makes the walk often. Each week, an envelope arrives from an expensive law firm in Boston, witness depositions, an action by the insurance carrier, letters from one lawyer to another with his name typed in at the bottom. "And send it to the cop," D'Angelo, sitting in his lawyer's office, smoothing the fabric of his tailored suit. "He's yanking my chain, reminding me that he hasn't forgotten me." The snow stings his eyes. At each step, a weight bounces off his hip, a slim 25 caliber Beretta with an extra clip stitched into the broad hem of his down jacket, held in place by a double loop of elastic, a strip of Velcro at the fold where, with a slight tug, the pocket drops free. Below the counter at the store, he had bolted a pair of wing clips to a ledge one evening, easing the tension with a screwdriver until they gripped the barrel of a 410-gauge pump with a pistol stock. Another, with the barrel sawed off to an inch, hangs from a pair of clips beneath the bed frame in his cabin. Many nights, as the wind howls through the trees beyond the window, he wakes with his body tensed and sweating, his hand reaching. A police-issue flak jacket dangles from a hook on the bedroom door. He eyes it as he dresses each morning, feeling naked as he slips his shirt on. He limps on through the whipping snow, his eyes scanning the cars parked along the square, watching the traffic for a sudden slowing, a passenger alone in the rear seat, a window open despite the cold. Safe. Chapter 3.
From his office window, Johnny D'Angelo looks down upon the back lot of South Boston Auto Repair, James P. Gallo, proprietor, a business in which he has no documented interest. At one end of the lot, a row of crumpled cars stands behind a wall of melting snow. During the last year, each car has been sold at least four times, the names on the transfers drawn from residents of nursing homes in the western part of the state. Only days after each sale, accident reports are submitted to the insurance companies, with damage listed a few $100s below the car's value. It is a very profitable business, which, by virtue of its three employees' vast appetites, deposits a large percentage of its income at the end of each week into the cash registers of its neighbor, D'Angelo's Pizza. Johnny D'Angelo shakes his head. Stupid, he thinks. They should push that snow out of the way. Some insurance guy has a slow afternoon, comes down here to look at the car. Maybe he remembers there hasn't been any snow in the last 3 weeks, starts thinking about how that car could get wrecked when it hasn't moved. He swivels his chair to face his desk. Across from him, Jackie Mullen from the South End leans forward, tapping one finger on the desk as he talks. Johnny shifts in his chair, not looking at him. Fat Jackie, like a meatball in that cheap suit. This guy, he's into me for $3,200 this month alone, over $15,000 for the year. I got two guys in the hospital. He tried to run him down with a fucking Buick. Fat Jackie settles back in his chair, one hand raised like he's trying to stop a bus. You and me, we've had our problems over the years, but we always worked it out. But this guy, he's way out of line. I'm supporting him and his whole family here. Don't get me wrong, it's not the money, Johnny. I got money. You hear what I say? Fuck the money. It's the lack of respect. I'm supposed to let him walk away from this just because he's going to marry your daughter? I ask you. He spends too much time staring out the window lately, his stomach twisted with pain. Jimmy's a good guy. He doesn't think, is all. Let's things slide. I gotta send someone down there to get him to move that snow. Can't figure it out for himself. And yet, as he reaches for the phone, raising one finger to silence Fat Jackie, he knows it isn't the snow that bothers him. Nor the letter dangling from the sign for the last 3 weeks.
South Boston Auto Repair, just like you say it, Jimmy'd said, trying to get him to laugh.
Even Russo can figure it, standing with Jimmy while a kid drags a shovel out of the garage.
You gotta think, he tells Jimmy. He sits up there, staring at that oil spot on the pavement over by the fence. Only he doesn't want to look at it, so he looks at the sign or the snow or whatever.
He shakes his head.
It's gonna take him a while, Jimmy. He's gonna be on you about something until then.
And as he says it, they can see him in the window, one hand smoothing his tie with a practiced gesture, silver hair combed straight back, his face expressionless. Russo lets a hand fall on Jimmy's shoulder, gives it a shake.
You want my advice, Jimmy?
Russo sweeps his arm across the parking lot.
You get some black paint, get a truck in here during the night to move the cars for a couple hours, and do the whole lot. He doesn't see the oil every day. Maybe it won't bother him so much.
I don't know, Tommy. Used to be he had a gripe about me, he told me. I didn't have to hear it from you.
What do you want, Jimmy? It's like when we gotta go up the North End, up by where Vinny got killed. He makes me drive all the way down Hanover through all the traffic so we don't have to pass the street. He doesn't want to see it, you know? We get where we're going, he's in a bad mood. Tells me the shocks need work. Or he's in a restaurant, I can see him through the window, yelling at the waiter. Poor guy didn't do nothing, but he's angry, like with you.
You think he's angry at me?
Russo shrugs, tugs his collar up against the wind.
Not my problem, he thinks. Some guy over at the police yard wants the car off his lot, has it towed over to Jimmy's, dumps it in the back. And Jimmy, he gets shook at the police truck pulling up in back, so he lets him. Leaves it sitting out there, what, 6 weeks? He's looking at it every day, seeing Vinny's face like he was on the table, bits of glass in the little dish next to his head.
When he glances back at the window, it is empty. As Johnny settles into his chair, Fat Jackie leans forward once more. He doesn't like waiting, staring at D'Angelo's back while he watches some fucking kid shovel snow. He can feel the anger on his face, his skin hot. But he holds his temper, knowing if he walks out, he'll get no satisfaction. He plays along with it, waiting his chance. Now, as Johnny's eyes meet his own, he leans into him, keeps his voice quiet, takes his best shot.
"He's not your kid, Johnny. I known him since he was stealing cigarettes out of the machine down at the trailways. He's a punk, and he's done violence to my people."
He raises one finger, same as Johnny did, holds it there for a moment to make the point.
"Where I come from," he says, his voice almost a whisper, "we don't let that slide."
Johnny looks at him, his eyes tired.
"I'll take care of it," he says.
According to papers filed with a grand jury convened by the United States Attorney for the District of Massachusetts, D'Angelo's Pizza, Inc. employs 32 people at 6 retail outlets, another 12 at a central warehouse, and an administrative staff of 7, including its president and sole stockholder, John Anthony D'Angelo. The company employs an additional 7 people at 2 subsidiaries, D'Angelo Restaurant Supply and DRS Farms, Inc. After an evening slogging through the financial records, Haggerty had to admit she was impressed. The restaurants offered a documented cash source with register receipts to support the entire operation. The trick was that some of the sales were legitimate, a fact Haggerty saw from the file that had sunk Riccioli's last indictment. The restaurants sold pizza by the slice, by the pie, from an outlet 2 blocks from the federal courthouse. Haggerty smiled. Shook her head. Try telling a juror the place is a front when he's just eaten lunch there. Yet, a former employee had testified, reluctantly, Haggerty noted, to false receipts. A night manager who kept the cash registers chattering until dawn, recording sales that never took place. A good system, Haggerty thought. No way to prove the money's dirty. On the other end, the company bought all its supplies, flour, tomato sauce, cheese, kitchen equipment from the 2 subsidiaries, leaving a hazy trail of invoices and checks that hid the fact that no money was spent. From one pocket to the other, Haggerty thought. Lots of cash comes in, but nothing going out. Pure profit. The way Riccioli figured it, the money from drugs, truck hijacking, insurance fraud, kickbacks, was laundered through local banks as receipts from the pizza joints. For decades, criminal prosecutions had failed as witnesses under the stares of mob lawyers grew forgetful. In recent years, the prosecutors had turned to accountants where the police had failed. The guys on the Federal Organized Crime Task Force had a joke. The mob has a retirement plan. Death and taxes. By selling a few pizzas, D'Angelo could avoid the tax weasels. Haggerty had heard that during the last audit, the IRS boys had come away shaking their heads, claiming that the restaurant showed a documented profit. On the books, the income from the 6 pizza joints scattered across the city was larger than the combined sales of the 2 largest burger chains statewide. A lot of pizzas. Haggerty pushed the records aside. Stretched. She needed a run, a shower, more sleep. Too many hours in the office, chasing leads that had been checked dozens of times. For over a year, the D'Angelo file had remained in her files unopened. A week of surveillance during the funeral of D'Angelo's son had produced nothing, and Riccioli had abruptly pulled her from the case. As a last gesture to satisfy her own mania for order, she had scribbled a note to a file clerk she was cultivating at the Department of Corrections, requesting, along with the name of her hairstylist, notice of the disposition of the charges against the police officer, sentence imposed, and estimated date of release. The clerk's note returned a few days later, and she dropped it into the file and forgot it. When, almost a year later, she found on her desk a notice of release for Walsh John D. vehicular homicide, it took her a moment to make the connection. She set her briefcase on the floor, slipped off her shoes, and slumped into her chair. It was late, and she was tired. The street light shimmered through a thin rain beyond the window. The tiny office was strewn with files, stacks of papers, exhibit boxes. The ancient leather chair was cracked, the stuffing spilling out in several places. She had draped it with a Navajo shawl held in place by strips of masking tape. At idle moments, her fingers sought the fringes taped to the base of the chair, twirling them into elaborate knots. She picked up the paper, tapped it with one finger. Footsteps receded down the dark hall. The cop! She pushed back from the desk with one foot, tugging at a heavy file drawer. The folder was covered with a thin layer of dust. At the back of the file, she found three sheets, captioned in boldface, "Update to Main File," that Janice, her secretary, had slipped into the folder when she was out. The sheets were dated in the last 4 months. Someone's been working the file, Haggerty thought. Funny no one mentioned it. She shrugged. It wasn't her case. If Riccioli wanted to reassign it, that was his business. She had too much work as it was, too little time off, no life beyond the walls of this tiny office. She stuffed the release form into the file and shoved it into the drawer. She hooked the edge of the metal drawer with her toes to shove it closed, then paused. If the file was active, she should keep up with it. Riccioli knew she had done the background. If he assigned it to her, there would be no time to catch up. She sighed, lifted the file back onto her lap. The tax reports took hours. When she found her mind drifting, she got up, switched off the office light. In the darkness, she fumbled for the desk lamp, feeling her senses grow alert. She bent the lamp down, so the only light in the room was the glare that reflected off the pages. An old law school trick: eliminate the distractions. Confused by the details of corporate structure, she sketched a series of boxes on a legal pad, marking one pizzas, the next supplier, which she linked by a dotted line to farms. Below that, she drew a series of arrows, charting the flow of money from the restaurants to the subsidiary companies, and by a complicated series of transfers, back into the main company. A very clever boy, our Johnny. When she felt that she had glimpsed the faint trail of money from the cash registers in the restaurants to the private accounts at the bank, she stuffed the reports back into the file. Again, as she slid the thick folder into the drawer, she hesitated. The updates. She pushed the chair back to her desk, noted the dates from the forms on her legal pad. She bit her lip for a moment, then retrieved the release form on the cop. All right, maybe it means nothing. Maybe you're obsessive. Disappointed it never came to anything. That's what Riccioli will think. Still, it can't hurt to get it in the file. She gathered her papers, glancing at her watch. 9:50. The file room closed at 10 o'clock. She would have to sign the file out and get it back first thing in the morning. Another late night. When she got home, she spread the file on her couch, flicked on the television to chase the silence from the tiny apartment. The furniture, a battered couch and oak coffee table painted an unspeakable brown, and her father's old leather recliner, had emerged from her parents' attic when she left for college, following her to law school. She kicked off her shoes, scratched the soles of her feet on the edge of the table. One day. Taking up the file, she added the release notice to the jumble of papers at the back of the file and initialed the change on the file log, alerting the file clerk to send out update notices. Next, she flipped through her own reports on the surveillance 2 years before, looking for comments in Riccioli's cramped hand. A red marker had noted D'Angelo's spotting the surveillance van, an exclamation mark in the margin. So do it better, asshole. She flipped to the back of the file. There were only two new entries. She consulted the dates on her legal pad, confirmed that a third update notice had gone out only 3 weeks before. She sorted through the clipped pages more slowly, found nothing more recent than January. Well, shit. She would have to ask the file clerk, a silent woman who loathed disorder in her files. Haggerty could imagine her scowling, glaring at her with suspicion. She shrugged. Not my fault. She set the file aside, stretched out on the couch with the new entries, a recent IRS report concluding that there was insufficient evidence for prosecution on tax fraud charges,
and stapled to a blank sheet of paper an embossed wedding invitation, folded once, addressed to Thomas Riccioli, United States Attorney. Inside, in a flowing script, Mr. and Mrs. John A. D'Angelo request the pleasure of your company at the wedding of their daughter, Maria D'Angelo, and Francis Anthony DeFeo, Sunday, February 10, 1991, at 2 o'clock p.m., St. Vincent's Church, Boston. That's balls, she laughed. Good for you, Johnny. Attached to the sheet was a news clipping, assault charges dropped, and a photograph of a young man pushing through a crowd of reporters. Beside the photograph, Riccioli had scrawled, Frankie DeFeo meets the press. She glanced at the clipping. A fight in a bar in Revere spilled out into the parking lot. Frankie had taken an axe handle from his car and broken three ribs on some kid from Saugus. The kid filed charges, then refused to testify when the case came to trial. Little league stuff, Haggerty thought. Must be ambitious, though, marrying Johnny's girl. She remembered a photograph of the daughter from the cop's sentencing, clutching her mother's arm, shouting at the press. Pretty girl. Small, with angry eyes, a cascade of black hair across her shoulders.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.